नीलातुङ्गस्तनगिरितटी सुप्तमुद्बोध्य कृष्णं पारार्थ्यं स्वं श्रुतिशतशिरःसिद्धमध्यापयन्ती स्वोच्छिष्टायां सृजिनिगळितं या बलात्कृत्य भुङ्क्ते गोदा तस्यै नम इदमिदं भूय एवास्तु भूयः। जय श्रीमन्नारायण। प्रिय भगवद्बन्धो, धनुर्मासं स्टार्टेड्, गोदा देवी इज लीडिंग अस to teach us the values of the life. But we are interested much in listening to stories. So Goda Devi wants to tell a few stories. Thus, she wants to teach some hidden message in each of these stories. So externally, it's just a nice story of a few girls who are waking up each other and proceeding towards the Krishna's palace. But internally, it's the way of the life that we have to understand to enhance the value of our life. So it's a beautiful poetry. Started the Vratam, Goda Devi gave 5 songs to talk about the origin of this universe, how it is created. And then the one who creates this beautiful and vast universe, how he conducts himself to cater the needs of the souls who are in different phases, like a few who are eternal, how he keeps himself, and to make the system run, how he keeps himself. And when there are troubles, there are issues, to resolve them, how he comes down in different forms. And at the same time, to run the system, how he keeps himself as the indweller of each soul. But to understand the value and to do something to these people, to these souls, how he appears in a deity form, so that anybody can do something, anybody can offer something, and anybody can focus on him. So how he comes as a deity? So a 5-phased form of God has been explained in the first package of 5 songs. And then, to keep us fixed with this, how great people will be always around us and how we have to be under their guidance so that we also can raise to a level where from we will be keeping ourselves undisturbed with the waves of the world, so that we can lead our life in a better way. It is always the company of good people which gives us the confidence, which makes us strong to face any kind of situation. Just like the lamp, when we keep outside, and then there will be constant blow of the winds, and we need a chimney over that. And as long as the chimney is there, then the glow will be constant. Otherwise, it keeps waving, or sometimes it may get extinguished. So, How strong we keep the chimney is what matters. But physically and of course externally, we can bring a glass and just make a chimney and keep a shield over the lamp. But what about the knowledge? What about insight? Because the life itself is, you know, runs because of the knowledge. And that knowledge should be constantly glowing so that, you know, we can lead our life in a better way. Definitely there will be wind blows constantly coming, but how to make it steady and what a kind of chimney that we have to keep over that lamp. And that is what Goda Devi is introducing us in the form of nice story. The inner knowledge is called prajna. Knowledge is called jnana. And if it is a better knowledge to give a kind of protection to us, is called prajna. So, for us, we need a prajna prasadam, a perfect shield all around us so that we keep ourselves in that and still just we can move with the worldly things where though there are wind blows, they won't disturb the glow of the lamp. So the prajna prasadam must be strong. In ninth song of Tiruppavai, Goda Devi introduces us the prajna prasadam. If it is strong enough, nothing will disturb us, no matter what kind of onslaughts, you know, fall on us. But to make our knowledge that strong, to become a shield around us to face any kind of eventualities, there will be steps. At a stage, we won't be able to grow to that extent where it becomes so strong shield for us. There will be a step down and then another step down and then a beginning step. There will be steps like that. So it's a kind of journey basically, the journey of the knowledge. Look that we are here and we have to reach this stage, which is insight. It's not an external journey. External journey is easy for us so that we can see the so many things around and then just we can move. But inner journey is very difficult for us. We don't know whether we are proceeding forward or we are going backward. So the great acharyas, those who practice the inner journey, they give us glimpses of that journey. But how to make the journey? Look, we are here and we have to reach a goal. But first of all, we are not towards the goal. The basic thing is that we are in the reverse mode. If these are our senses controlled by the manas, the inner instrument, what we call it, manas. Some people, of course, they in a loose term, they take it as the mind, but it doesn't matter. But the manas is the controller of all the sensory organs. And all these, the six instruments, like the five sensory organs and the controller manas, they are always outwards. They are acquainted with the worldly things. And what we need? We need to make our journey inward, because the one who controls us or the one who controls the entire universe is within us only. The beauty of the human life is we can understand that the power of God is within us. We can understand whether we make our journey towards that universal power or not, that depends, of course, upon the people who make their efforts. But that power is very much within us. So God is the indweller. He is with you. He is very much with us. That means how powerful we are, how great we are, if we realize. But most of the times, the realization is very difficult. A reason, our senses, and the one who has to give us the strong decision, the manas, is also with the senses, with those organs, and all they are just outwards. They are acquainted with the worldly things, and they are very much with them. And of course, they want them only most of the times. But we have to make our journey towards this, the inner power who is with us. What we need to do? First, we have to see that they come back from them. Because they are very much acquainted, we have to just, first of all, just bring them from the clutches of the external attractions. But that itself is a very difficult task, isn't it? And then once we bring them back, then we have to see that they turn towards the inner one. The inner one is always towards us only. But first you have to turn it, and then you have to take it to make its journey towards the inner one. This journey also is very difficult, because once you started journey towards that, again the previous experiences, they constantly calling us, and they are giving us so many warnings, and sometimes they fear us also. So once we turn them and then start our journey, again they keep dragging us back, they keep us dragging. And not getting attracted towards them and making the journey itself is a very, very difficult thing. But if at all, once we start doing that, and then slowly, slowly reaching towards that and joining that is the ultimate thing, what is to be done, what we need to do. But my God, this is, you know, this is for what actually our great munis, sages, rishis, all these guys are putting their, you know, all efforts for thousands of years, probably. But still, many could not achieve. We heard the stories of like Vishwamitra, etc., who they wanted to give up and wanted to turn towards the inner force and put their efforts for 10,000 years, it seems, in one direction. And again, he just started his journey and again turned back and fall. Again, there is another fall. Again, he woke up, started journey again, started pursuing a little extent, again gone back, fell down, again woke up, again started journey, again another fall. He went towards south, acquired something, but gone. Went towards west, gone. North, did tapas. He started that, the problem is with the directions. He thought that on the east, he did not go first. That was his last option. He went towards south, did tapas. And of course, he fell down. Then he thought the south is not good. So probably we have to choose another direction. And then he went towards west, did tapas there. And there also again another obstacle. And again he has fallen down. Then he thought, no, even west is also not good. South is good, west is good, north is good, everything is good. Our intentions are not good, you know. He forgot that. He thought that bad is outside. No, bad is inside, as a matter of fact. And so, on whichever direction he has gone, There he acquired some power and again he lost totally and again went to other direction, acquired something and again lost. Thus, south, west, north, all those three directions, he spent 10,000 of years. And of course, finally, he came towards the east, did his tapas, and he confirmed that I should not get disturbed by any kind of things. And then, oh, he did severe tapas. And then finally, after 10,000 years of his time, and then he wanted to just eat a little food. And then Indra came there and said, just like under the guise of a beggar, and said, sir, hunger. And then he knew that the one who came was Indra. Earlier, he used to curse immediately, but now he said, okay, that's it, no problem, take it. Simply he gave it. So he came to a stage where he just was able to control himself to some extent. Then the devatas were pretty much pleased and they said, oh, my goodness, you really became, you know, a great rishi. You became a great rishi like a devarshi. He said, devarshi, I want a brahmarshi. I am not happy with the devarshi. So I don't care. And then he again sat down in tapas. And finally, of course, Brahmaji has come there and said, okay, I consider you as Brahmarshi, okay? He said, I don't care you. And who want to say? Vasishtha should say. Because that was his counterpart. So he said, Vasishtha should come and say that I am Brahmarshi. Okay. Then Vasishtha said, nothing problem. Come on, let me come and say. And then he said, hey Vishwamitra, yes, you now became a Brahmarshi. Because you are able to control so much, so you became Brahmarshi. That's okay. His ego was totally satisfied by this. Because the Vasishtha himself has come and said that you became a Brahmarshi. And then he was happy, you know. He was so ripened at a stage, you know, because of his, the tapas, the purity that he acquired was such. The moment his ego was totally given up, he just surrendered to Vasishtha and touched the feet of Vasishtha and said, I am your disciple. You know, Vasishtha was so happy. Vasishtha says, you know, he never expects anything. And Vasishtha said, that's okay. So the point what we need to understand here is, in spite of thousands of years of penance, in those days, when everything was pure, air was pure, water was pure, earth was pure, and you know, trees were pure, everything was pure. Even in those days also, it was so difficult to make the inner journey towards the goal. What to say about the days we are going through, where everything is polluted, terribly corrupted, you know. Even the corruption also got corrupted. What to say, anything, other things. You know, everything is polluted. So is it easy to acquire such a kind of perfection? Goda Devi assures us, yes, it's possible. With the case of Vishwamitra, he wanted to acquire that all alone. So it became very difficult for him. But if we have the company of great people, definitely we'll be able to acquire that, what is called as satsang. The company of good people, that gives us really tremendous energy, great support, and then we can make our journey easy. See, when the hole is like this, and you want to insert by yourself like this, and then you won't be able to do it. It's only just stress, strain, and pain only remain there. Take guidance. They will tell you, hey, turn it like this. It can easily be accommodated, you know, with no effort. So simple it becomes. But you need people who will be able to guide you to turn this and just, you know, just move ahead. That's the greatness of good people, the satsang that gives you this kind of ways out. Goda Devi, in this Dhanurmasa, is giving us such kind of satsang to us. And it's, you know, not just she's teaching us the morals, not that she's teaching us any kind of, you know, the values, but she only teaches nice stories. The exoteric, it's only just, you know, a story of little girls. But there is a nice esoteric meaning, which if we are a little bit careful to understand, yes, you can definitely make something valuable out of it. There are steps, what we said. The first step is pull them from those things. Just, you know, we'll tell you something like, you know, a person is pretty much interested in eating. He's a master in eating. You know, he acquired doctorate in eating. So that's okay. But he wanted to just give up such kind of things. You know, what has to do, first of all? Some people say, you know, without that, I cannot eat food. You know, with every bowl, I need something. You know, otherwise, I just can't eat any sort of food. There are some people like that. Suppose you are upset with your spouse, then what do you do? You out of that, you know, out of grief or anger, you say, I don't want to eat it, though you like it so much. But that inner anger that makes you to avoid it, to stop it. You said, I don't want. Okay, let it be anger or let it be something else. You are able to keep it away, at least for some time. At least for a couple of days, as long as that anger is there, isn't it? So, what you thought cannot be avoided, you are able to avoid at least for a little time. Try to extend it to one more day, one more day, one more day. Becomes difficult initially. But bear with it for a moment. Then you are able to just come back from that. So far you are so attached to that, you come back a little. That is out of anger you are doing. But now start doing that out of love. You love a person so much and that person is not there with you currently. So you say, if I am with the person, I love to eat it, but that person is not with me, how can I eat it? Even such kind of feel also makes you to keep the things away from you, at least for a moment. So you just come back from that. That is the initial practice. And if you are able to bear with for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, then the inner sense keep crying, oh, oh, oh. But there is a kind of feel that makes you to keep it away and keep that feel awakened so that you can take it back for a little more extent. if you do it for, say, a week, a couple of weeks, then a month, yeah, you are able to do that. You are able to, you know, keep it away from you, at least for some time. I think nowadays there are people who take dikshas, like Ayyappa Diksha, etc. Though they are very much, you know, used to eat something and drink something, when they take that diksha, they keep it totally away from them, at least for that period. That means they are able to do that. But of course, they are not strong enough in giving it up. So what happens? Once the period is over, like then 20 days or 40 days or something like that, then all of a sudden they compensate it, all the 40 days stuff, in just 2 days. But it's a different story, you know, because their intention is not that to give it up. Their intention is to acquire something by the diksha. So they won't give it up. But if our intention is to give it up, then see, on the name of diksha or on the name of something else, start keeping a little distance from that. Initially, it becomes a difficult thing. Then slowly, 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 you get acquainted. There are some people who go to Kasi or Prayag or Gaya, like places. Then after performing some kind of alms to their departed souls, they give up something which they like much. There was a person who used to like, you know, jackfruit so much. After that love, in his home, he grew so many jack trees. So because he wanted them. But what happened? Once he went to Gaya and then he gave them up. Because they said, whatever you like so much, on the name of the departed soul, you have to just, you know, dedicate it to them. Then all of a sudden he was able to recollect the jackfruit, and then he said, jackfruit samarpayami. Yes, he gave it. That is over. But when he returned, it was nice summer. The trees are full of jackfruits, beautiful fragrance. And then, but the moment he sees the jackfruit, he used to feel very bad, you know, because he loves it so much, but he gave it up. And then what to do now? So initially it was very difficult, and he was able to give it up for, say, 1 year. Then a kind of confidence came into his mind. Yes, I am able to live even without that. And of course, after a few years, he moved from that home. And then he was able to forget it. But you know what happened after 10 years? Somebody brought a few jackfruits. Yeah, this fruit is nice. This fruit is not. The moment he looked at that, he was able to identify which fruit is good, which fruit is not good. Because there are samskaras inside, which again pop up and again take him towards them. So what is initially is doing, he was very much attached to that. But with force, he started just pulling them back. As long as the fruit is with him, then again, you know, he'll be constantly crying, 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 within the heart, not physically. But in heart he cries. But slowly, 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 he was able to, you know, go back from them. And then he moved away from that place. And so, at least, as long as he's not seeing that, he was able to forget about it. Came you know, a little away from that. And then started trying it back. But somebody brings it and then it goes towards that. Somebody throws it, again it goes towards that. Then, because he just kept away from that, it slowly started turning back. And then journey started. But see, when we are experiencing the things, it creates a few records in us, right? Those records are very much with us, the past records. Those records, sometimes, no, they'll be coming up when we see that, or else when we are sleeping, the dream comes as if we are going through a jhak, a tree garden, and then there are nice jhak fruits, and then we plucked one and cut it and picked out those the raisins, you know, and then as if just we are eating, something comes like a dream, gone. And see, in the dream again, it disturbs. Of course, by giving positive thoughts to that, again, it makes its journey slowly. And then 20 years passed. Then what happens? Sometimes, you know, during some occasions, it pops up again into mind. And so when, you know, I was there, I was doing like that, he says. Some people say, no, I did not see movies since 20 years. That means in his mind, the movie samskara is there. Though it is 20 years since he touched them, but the samskara is still there, you know, it is coming sometimes. But a stage comes when the journey goes forward with the satsang. What we need to remember is, with the positive things all around, when he makes his journey forward, then a stage comes. Though there are jackfruits all around, then he don't feel that they are just jackfruits, or there is something for him to do with them. Though they are there with him, but he never cares them. And then he, after making journey for some more, probably years or decades, we don't know, but the effort goes on, and ultimately he reaches a place where, though he is, you know, in the jhak trees, in the amidst jhak trees, but he never cares them at all. But reaching that stage is very difficult. I gave the jackfruits example because we know eating them and we know the samskaras of those things, you know. Not just all jackfruits, but there are thousands of things around us with which we are very much acquainted. Jai Sriman Narayana.